Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Good evening. Welcome to another edition of Centering on Peace. My name is Faramarz Farbod. I teach politics at Moravian University, and I'm an editor of a journal of critical opinion called Left Turn. I'm very pleased to have my good friend, Cambiz Khosravi, joining us tonight. He's a documentarian. He was born in New York City of Iranian parentage. So hello, Cambiz.
Hi, Faramarz, and thank you for having me.
You're more than welcome. Why don't we begin by you telling the audience just a little bit about yourself, where you come from, how you ended up being who you are at the moment?
Okay, as you mentioned, I was born in New York City of Iranian parents, and I lived in Iran till I was 10. Now, the most important thing is that when I was in Iran at the age of 9, the 1953 coup happened, and it happened practically outside my door. And so I witnessed it. But then, of course, as a 9-year-old, all I saw was visceral effects that really shocked me. But later on, as I grew and as I found out what were the real reasons behind this shocking episode that I was witnessing at that time. Mm-hmm. And so in 2015, I decided to make a documentary called Inheritance, which this particular 20 minutes that you're going to be showing, I took out to give an overview of why Iran is the way it is at the moment. Mm-hmm. And I have some very wonderful experts who gave me of their time and educated me, and then hopefully will, although I hate the word educating, but give us insight into why Iran became the way it is now. And then, of course, how it's viewed mainly in the West. If you want to see the full documentary, it's called Inheritance. Let me show you the poster.
Mm-hmm. Please do. Yes.
Can you see it?
If you lift it up a little bit, we can see the pictures too. The young you, I can see there's Cambiz, young Cambiz in the middle. Yeah.
Okay. So, anyways, they can see it on either a shorter version on Amazon Prime, mm-hmm. Under the name Inheritance of the Film, because there were so many other inheritances. Mm-hmm. But I would suggest that they should go on Vimeo and type in Inheritance and then my name. And then they will be able to see a fuller version with a lot of insight into what I feel is a very important thing that should be out there. So anyways, that's that. So I hope you'll get insight into our country, which could be attacked any moment as we speak. And so why don't you roll the film and then we'll discuss it further, if that's okay, if you want to know anything else.
No, that's okay. I just would want to wholeheartedly support what you just said, both in terms of trying to understand the current situation in the West Asia, including what's going on with Iran, as well as people should watch your documentary. I have shown your documentary many, many times in my classes that I teach. I teach Middle East politics at Moravian University. I've taught that, and I've shown your documentary there, and I've shown it in other venues too. And every time I do show it, there's a very positive reception. So people ought to go on.
Thank you. Thank you for doing that.
No, thank you for making an insightful documentary. So let's go to the showing of this 22 minutes version. We'll come back afterwards.
Here is Bob Dyke in Tehran.
This picture tells it all. 2 days earlier, several hundred young people, mainly students at Tehran University, had taken over the embassy. We are not occupiers, they said. We have thrown out the occupiers.
Just as the hostage crisis is seen by many Americans as the be-all and end-all of U.S.-Iran relations, Iranians have an episode that they look at as the crucial moment in the history of U.S.-Iran relations.
The Near East became another world trouble spot with the nationalization and seizure of the world's largest oil refinery in Abadan in Iran. A fifth of the world's oil supply was cut off, and nationalist feeling ran high against Britain and the Western democracies. Premier Mossadegh, spearhead of the oil nationalization program, took his case to the United Nations, where he remained adamant in his stand and raised the specter of possible Russian intervention and acquisition of the huge oil reserves. It was but one of the difficult questions that faced the United Nations in a year of stalemate between the free nations and those of the Iron Curtain.
At that time, there were so many daily demonstrations that I thought it was normal. In hindsight, though, probably the most important recollection of my childhood was the day I walked out of the front door of my aunt's house in the center of Tehran. Suddenly, a shot hits the ground before me. To my left, a man called out Mossadegh's name, and immediately a gang of thugs surrounded him and start beating him up. Then they toss his lifeless body on top of the bus while screaming pro-Shah slogans. Stunned, I just stood there. Across the street, people are looting Mossadegh's home. They're carrying mattresses, sink faucets, all kinds of household objects. Little did I know then how my life would be shaped by just one day, August 19, 1953.
In no uncertain manner, and after 9 hours of bloodshed, the forces of the Shah were in command, and Mossadegh's reign as virtual dictator of Iran had ended. Once again, the thoughts of the populace turned towards their sovereign as they waited for his return.
How do you overthrow a government? CIA sent its senior Middle East operative, a guy named Kermit Roosevelt, to Iran with the mandate, overthrow this government. Kermit Roosevelt arrived and immediately began passing money around. Within a very short time, he had more than half of Iran's newspapers on the CIA payroll. And then he hired a gang of street thugs to charge through the streets and beat up pedestrians and smash shop windows and shoot their guns into mosques and yell, "We love Mossadegh and communism." And then he did something which was really smart. He actually hired a second street gang to attack the first street gang. So the streets of Tehran were in chaos and violent.
Mossadegh made one fatal mistake. This is the day before the coup. He basically asked his supporters to stay home.
Mossadegh was in some ways a perfect victim because, having lived in Switzerland and being a deep believer in democracy, He didn't want to use the brute power of the state to repress demonstrators. The coup came very close to failing, and in fact, did fail before a second attempt succeeded.
Crown Prince Abdullah greets the Shah as he lands at Baghdad Airport after a seven-hour flight from Rome. Here, he was to remain overnight as the guest of King Faisal before completing the journey to Tehran. Meanwhile, in Tehran itself, all stood ready to welcome the return of the Shah after the dramatic development in events which first compelled him to flee and then led to a royalist coup d'etat in which Mossadegh was arrested. Now, everywhere, supporters throng the streets proclaiming their loyalty to the Shah. General Zahidi, the new premier, emerges as the hero of the hour, for he it was who took charge of events and organized the movement that threw Mossadegh from power. The ruins of Mossadegh's residence bear witness to the fury of the mob, and the clash of conflicting loyalties is well illustrated by the damaged statue of the Shah's father. But now order is restored, and General Zahidi has the proud duty of proceeding to the airport to greet the returning sovereign. Later, in an interview granted to the international press, General Zahidi disclosed that he had formed his cabinet. And now with escort, the Shah arrives. It's greetings, cheers and flowers all the way for their monarch, who now faces the arduous task of putting his country's affairs in order.
When the Shah had fled after the failed coup,
further pictures from Tehran show rioters in action as anti-royalist partisans, supporters of the...
There had been spontaneous demonstrations, a lot of statues were broken, anything symbolizing the monarchy was smashed. So there had been a sort of chaotic situation on the street.
At the moment that Mossadegh fled from the back of his house after a mob backed by the army had arrived in front, Kermit Roosevelt decided it was time to go and find General Zahidi, who he had stashed in a safe house, and bring him to the radio station so he could announce, "I am the new prime minister, the evil Mossadegh is gone, and the Shah will be coming back as our great leader." The radio station announcers hustled to find some martial music. They put the music on. It was a bit unfamiliar to the people in the room, and slowly somebody realized that this was not Iranian patriotic music, but actually it was...
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose red stripes and bright stars through the pale.
I saw daily front page news photos of individuals being executed by firing squads. I also remember being made to line up on the street with other school kids waving American flags to welcome Vice President Richard Nixon's visit to Iran. The streets had been covered several inch deep in soil, a precaution to prevent anyone scattering nails and puncturing tires.
So it's all right to say that America did things that were not good, but it was done, after all, in order to save the country from communism. So that legitimizes the coup. I would like to get basically out of that context and look at it much more in terms of economic reasons.
Or was it for geostrategic and political reasons? The more I think about it, the more I realize that there really isn't any difference between the two. In the minds of the Dulles brothers, any government that was threatening big global corporate interests was, by definition, a geopolitical threat and probably in league with America's Cold War enemies. So they brought this mindset into power. The first target they had was Mossadegh. And the reason why they targeted him first and then President Arbenz in Guatemala second is that those two leaders had attacked companies that they worked for and worked with and represented while they were private lawyers.
When I was doing the research on for my book, I found a very seasoned diplomat. He didn't know anything about that there had been a CIA involvement in the coup. So here you have actually a diplomat who is trained to work in Iran. Somehow no one had bothered to tell him about it, and he has to discover it from an Iranian. You know, I'm sure at first, when they first heard it, he thought this was a typical Iranian paranoia. The real reason for the coup was both the Americans and the British were adamant that nationalization should not succeed.
After the 1953 coup, the Shah's army and police began rounding up members of the Today Party and Mossadegh supporters.
If Mossadegh had succeeded in 53, I would guess that by the late 50s, countries like Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Iraq would have nationalized their oil. Instead, they had to wait really to the 70s and 80s to nationalize. So the trend basically was not changed. It was the timing change. Almost all the leading figures, Iranians in the coup, were eased out 4 or 5 years later. Zahedi, for instance, was sent off to his mansion in Switzerland. From the Shah's point of view, if they had worked with the CIA to bring him to power, they might actually work with the CIA to get rid of him in future.
While in Iran, the Shah's pictures were everywhere. Before beginning of every movie, you had to stand up to the strains of the national anthem with the Shah in various regal poses. I still can sing the anthem they taught us as children. Shahan Shahe Mazendebada. I had no idea about the Savak, the Shah's secret police that had been trained by the CIA. And oh yes, none other than Major General Herbert Norman Schwarzkopf, the father of Desert Storm Norm, he trained virtually all of the first generation of Savak personnel. Look it up, don't take my word for it.
Isfahan is one of the main bases for the Shah's helicopter fleet, which is second only to that of the United States. But this was the day in Isfahan for demonstrations in favor of the Shah, though there was more than a hint that the action was being orchestrated. The army were out in large numbers from early morning, stopping cars, giving the passengers pictures of the Shah, and telling them to sound their horns and turn on their headlights to show support for the regime.
Imam Khomeini, Khomeini, Ruhollah. Ruhollah, Ruhollah. Isa Ruhollah, Muhammad Rasulullah.
1979 revolution took Westerners by surprise. It really didn't take Iranians by surprise, because for many Iranians, the Shah really never had national credibility. To compound that, he signed an agreement with the oil companies, which really undid Mossadegh's nationalization. Then on top of that, he gave what Iranians called capitulations to the United States. He gave U.S. Military advisors exemption from Iranian law. In Iran, it was actually explosive. Even members of his handpicked parliament were opposed to the capitulations. Khomeini took advantage of this to come to the forefront and denounce the whole agreement. And this is the first time Khomeini became actually a national figure. What Khomeini was actually doing was both appealing to the religious opposition, because he used religious language about foreign infidels getting such concessions, but he was also appealing to secular nationalists, supporters of Mossad there, who had their old grievances against the Shah, by saying, well, Iran is being sold to the Westerners. After 63, really, the Shah remained in power, in part because there was a lot of oil money coming in. He tried to buy people off, and basically by brute force. So the secret police, SAVAK, became more and more important. And by 79, this unraveled in part because the human rights policy of the Carter administration put restrictions on the SAVAK behavior. And also the oil boom, actually, there was a lot of money, but the way the money was spent created actually more of a backlash.
Just as the hostage crisis is seen by many Americans as the be-all and end-all of U.S.-Iran relations, Iranians have an episode that they look at as the crucial moment in the history of U.S.-Iran relations.
The Shah, who had fled to Rome, comes home, backed by General Zahedi, military strongman, who engineered his return to power. Iranian oil may again flow westward.
Why is it that I went to private schools my whole life and I was never taught any of this?
How come I never knew any of this? I had read a lot of history books. I never read about any of this. I studied history in college. Why wasn't I ever taught any of this? I have gotten this over and over and over again.
Fundamentalism took hold with a fury and a force that helped ignite the still impoverished masses in Iran, who felt they had little reason to be grateful to the Shah.
I don't think in those 444 days the CIA coup of 53 was once mentioned.
The preoccupation in Tehran still seems to be over whether the Shah would leave Iran once a new civilian government is formed.
The Shah has our support and he also has our confidence.
This couldn't have been just accidental. I think there was a policy, definite from above, that you don't mention the CIA coup, even though, of course, the students who had taken over the embassy, taken the hostages, because of the 53 coup. So I would have imagined American viewers would have been bewildered, you know, what's going on? The Iranians must be crazy.
To touch him, one man said, is to touch the person who speaks to God.
What is this all about? Because they were never really told what was the real reason for the anger at the other end.
A new and more turbulent era for Iran had begun. The reign of Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, the man who ruled Iran through four decades, came to an end.
I think maybe the reason why episodes like the Mossadegh coup are not part of our history lessons is that they don't show the United States the way we imagine ourselves to be. The Dulles brothers and the people who organized that coup had no idea of the concept that we now call blowback, the idea that bad things can happen over the long run when you intervene violently in other countries. So right after the coup happened, it seemed like it was a great success. We got rid of a guy we didn't like, Mossadegh, and we put in someone else, the Shah, who would do everything we wanted. It seemed like the perfect outcome. And in fact, you could have continued to argue that the coup was a success for the next 25 years. But now, as we look back on it, it doesn't really look quite so successful. Because of the 1953 coup, the Shah came back to power, and he intensified his repression over a period of 25 years. That intensifying repression produced the explosion of the late 1970s that we now call the Islamic Revolution. That revolution led to the emergence of a fanatically anti-American regime that has spent decades working intently and sometimes very violently to undermine American and Western power all over the world. Religious fundamentalists there, as in other countries, realized we don't have to spend our whole lives chanting in the corner of mosques. We can go out and try to seize the reins of state power. I see a three-part process going on in most of these operations. A leader of a country, like Mossadegh, begins to interfere with the way foreign corporations operate in his country. The second thing that happens is that inside the foreign policy process, so inside the White House, if you want to put it that way, the motivation morphs, it changes. People look at someone like Mossadegh and they say, well, if he is bothering a giant corporation, the functioning of which is vital to our idea of the world economy, it must mean that he's anti-capitalist and he's anti-American and he's probably in league with our enemies. Therefore, we must overthrow him, but not because he's bothering these companies, only because his harassment of these companies proves that he must be our political enemy. The third stage comes after the operation is done. It's time now to explain to Americans and to the world why we did this. Then we abandon both of those first two reasons. We come up with a new reason that we never even mentioned when we were planning the coup, and that is we only did it to help the poor, suffering people in that country. We did it to liberate them. They were being brutally oppressed, and we wanted to get rid of their oppressor as a gift to that nation. We did it to protect human rights. This is always the excuse that we come up with after we finish overthrowing a country for other reasons.
Here is Bob Dyke in Tehran. This picture tells it all. 2 days earlier.
Okay. Let's see. We are back now. Thank you, Cambiz, for that wonderful, wonderful extended, let's say, excerpts from your inheritance, the film. Parts of it are there in that film, but I understand that you ended up adding some other materials that you had to make it this very, I think, relevant story that Americans should know. And before I get your opinion, I do want to affirm a couple of times what the people said, Kinzer and others in the film, that Americans really don't know about this history. You might say that this is a hidden history. When it comes to U.S. public. And I can even attest to the fact that I ran into a long time, three decades long history teacher at a high school, a local high school in Lehigh Valley, who was conversing with me. And he said that when he discovered that I was from Iran, he said that, he loves discussing Iran with his students. And of every year that he teaches in his high school history class, he spends a whole full month talking about Iran. And then in the course of my conversation with him, I asked him, That I'm sure that he does spend some time on the 1953 coup and the significance of August 19th. And he said, "What coup?" And said, "What do you mean, what coup? The coup in 1953 that toppled Mossadegh with the help of MI6 and the CIA." He said, "There's no such thing. You know, there's no such group. What's your evidence?" You know. So I won't go into the details of our conversation with the teacher, but it just astonished me that a high school teacher teaching history for 3 decades and spends a month on Iran in his class and had no clue that this actually took place. And I'm not talking about decades and decades ago. This conversation is probably about 10 years old. So yeah, August 19, 1953, you mentioned as a narrator in this 22 minutes that we watched that it changed your life. And you didn't really know. And now in retrospect, of course, it changed your life. But also it changed not only Iran's life, the political history of Iran, but you could even say the history of region and the history of the world, in a sense. So why don't we begin with that briefly, if you want to say a few words about how it changed your life, and then dive into what is your perspective of how August 1953 is relevant for today and how it changed the history of the region.
Well, I think this underlines what Abrahamian said about the diplomat who had no idea, and he thought that this was just another Iranian paranoia. So, I would say, and this is also happening at the moment and will happen on, the mainstream media is doing its job very well. It's propagating a certain viewpoint so for general public consumption. And in fact, the reason I juxtaposed, these British newsreels, and in fact even showed them again later on with the ABC footages, is to show how they give out information that they want people to take away. And that's why showing the newsreel from the Brits in 53, 54, and having the two experts talk about them gave us insight into first hearing the point of view of the Brits, because obviously their interests were mainly the Anglo-Persian oil company, and they wanted their oil back. Mm-hmm. And it's our country, but it's their oil. Mm-hmm. So anyways, it was the same awakening to me as a 9-year-old. All I saw was the horror in front of me. Mm-hmm. You know, people getting killed, people getting, all the riots, et cetera, et cetera. And I couldn't make any sense of it. It was all visceral. Mm-hmm. But now having these two wonderful people who gave of their time freely without having been paid for it and explained what in fact did happen and the history behind it gives us a whole insight into this is, I mean, we could go on and on about this. But the same thing is happening now with the way, for example, the pro-Israel point of view is 90% of the coverage, exactly like the Brits back home saw the coverage of what was happening in Iran. And exactly the same coverage as ABC was giving on Iran. And as Abrahamian so rightly put, the Americans would have thought these Iranians must be crazy. Mm-hmm. You know, why are they so fanatical? Why are they so irrational? Why are they so out there, so to speak, and not like us who are rational and deep thinkers, et cetera, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Now you see how the point of view is shaped by the mainstream media then as it is now. And hence the majority of the people get only one side of the view, and it's the side of the people in charge, for want of a better word. So that's why I re-showed at the end the same footage that you saw in the beginning, so that you then said, oh, I've seen this before, but now I'm seeing it with the knowledge that I got, and hence I'm not going to take it for face value, because I know why this happened. And the same thing as a nine-year-old, and actually, I don't want to be, well, let's put it this way. As a nine-year-old, you don't have much of a insight into what is going on besides what you see, empirical evidence. But when it's explained to you as a, well, let's see, you know, older person, shall we say, then you can say, oh, I didn't know that. Just like my wife asked Kinza, I was taught history in class. How come I didn't know about this? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And as he said, I get this over and over again. So hopefully this 20 minute was helpful in explaining why Iran is the way it is. The blowback of that coup of 1953. Mm-hmm. And so that I hope people will take away some insight into, oh, I didn't know that. And hence, here it is.
No, I think you're right. And in fact, I would suggest that the viewers, if it caught their interest, should think about this 22 minutes video as a springboard for further investigation into this history. And they can do well for themselves by actually reading the books that Ervand Abrahamian, that you showed, The Coup, for instance, and also reading the two books that Stephen Kinzer has written. One was called All the Shah's Men, which wasn't mentioned in this 22 minute, but one Overthrow. There's a chapter on this coup, and there are chapters on other overthrows that Americans also ought to know, and that's part of the hidden history.
Correct.
Just as important. So I do hope that people think in those terms and continue with their interest in this subject. If you're just joining us tonight, I'm talking to my dear friend, Cambiz Khosravi. He's a New York-born of Iranian heritage, documentarian, and we've just shown a bit of his documentary, and you can check it out on Amazon and Vimeo. It's called Inheritance, the Film, made in 2015 and won some accolades, I suppose, and that is, we can maybe talk about that too. Anyway, but here's the other thing I wanted to mention, emphasis from what we just watched, particularly what Ervand Abrahamian said in a clip that you showed, that he said the way to understand the kind of proper context to understand 1953 isn't necessarily the context that the powers that be presented, which is a Cold War context between, you know, United States and Soviet Union or anti-communism. The proper context was imperialism versus resource nationalism. That's in fact what was happening. And you kind of mentioned that, it says it's their oil, but it's our oil in their territory type thing, perspective. So empire, British and the US empire, we're pretty much interested in controlling Iran's oil interest as a very significant strategic commodity. And they opposed Mossadegh and overthrew him because he insisted on resource sovereignty, resource nationalism. Now, that context of imperialism versus, let's say, global South economic sovereignty is still relevant. That's why I think understanding that history is relevant, not only because it explains the subsequent developments in that region, per se, but also because that context, the proper context, also allows us to understand what's going on as of now, today. So we can even understand U.S.-Israeli adventurism or U.S.-Israeli colonization or settler colonization in the region precisely in that context again. Empire versus people who are oppressed and wish to be liberated. So liberation versus empire. That's the context that we need to be discussing. And if you'd like to comment a little bit, you know, I'm sure you've heard that there's a concept in CIA literature called blowback. And a way to understand what happened in Iran in 1979 and the rise of Khomeini and Khomeiniism and the Islamic Republic is to understand it as a blowback. Do you want to say a few words about that? Is that also commensurate with your understanding?
Oh, definitely. But before we even go there, in the United States, the whole concept that communism and the whole anti-communism was a way that it was used to stifle the labor unions and movements. Of course, there were some communists in the labor movement, but it had nothing to do with communism taking over the United States, et cetera, et cetera. This was a way of waving, I'm sorry to use the pun, red flag, and as a way of saying, well, you know, this is all communists, where in fact it had to do with stifling labor. And thank God, now labor is resurging and unions are becoming strong again. And so that particular instance is very relevant and similar to how it was used with Mossadegh and Iran as it being the difference of communism and nationalism. And hence we were on the side of good. As opposed to blowback, yes. I mean, if you do something like that, you can, as Kinzer rightly pointed out, you never know its consequences. Mm-hmm. And the consequences that are so anti-American at the moment are because Iran knows what happened in 53 and they don't want it to happen again. So, mm-hmm. of course, Khomeini took that and used it and got people together under the umbrella of the Islamic Republic so that then he could say never again. Mm-hmm. So yeah. That's, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And here, I think a bit of a discussion about Islamophobia might be helpful. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of times people, when they think about Islamophobia, they think maybe it's just some kind of a irrational fear of Muslims that doesn't have any foundation in anything structural in the system, let's say. But the way I look at it is Islamophobia serves empire.
Mm-hmm.
Deflecting attention from root causes of issues.
Right.
And getting the public to believe that whatever the U.S. policy is in relation to, let's say, the Muslim majority world is a consequence of the Muslim behavior, let's say. Whereas the case of Iran and August 19, 1953 should clarify that issue. Mm-hmm. A contest between imperialism and resource nationalism. And it,
right.
Homophobia serves that purpose. It's a functional discourse, if you will. for maintenance of empire.
Well, this is nothing new because always the other has been used through all history. And look at it now. For example, what happened in Germany with the Jews as being the used to rile up the people to go behind Hitler and the whole Nazi Nazism is now actually from my perspective in terms of movie making, it used to be Germans who were the bad guys. And all of a and then all of a sudden, anybody who is Iranian must be terrorists. So they, the Germans were replaced by Iranians and the Arabs as the bad guys. So yeah, it's the perception and how you get people to side with the way you want them to see things. And this is very, very, very important in terms of people realizing that they are being manipulated, for want of a better word. And I think Chomsky would be a good good person to read about the whole I'm
manufacturing
an
consent.
Old guy, so manufacturing consent, exactly. And how the media is used. And in fact, Goebbels, that's why he knew the media was the most important thing of shaping people's minds. As the McCarthyites were aware that, again, Hollywood was very important in terms of shaping people's minds. Hence, they went after Hollywood. So, anyways, I digress, but...
No, that's okay. Could I ask you to move your computer slightly, shift it so we can see the top of your head too? I think...
Oh, I'm sorry.
There you go. A little bit.
Well, it's because I think so much, you know, my...
That's it. You're eliminating the cerebral cortex.
Exactly. I don't want to show everybody all of my... Never mind.
So I think it's for those of us who are joining, those of you who are joining us, again, I'm talking to Cambiz Khosravi. He's a documentarian. We've showed an extended excerpt of his documentary called The Inheritance, the film. I highly recommend it to the viewers if you've joined. You can check it out. Google his name. Now, getting back to what we were saying, it's like a puzzle. I'd like to know your opinion. When we talk about manipulation of public opinion, usually one thinks that we're talking about, let's say, ordinary people who are busy with their lives, going to work, coming back. They don't have positions of authority, cultural authority, managerial positions, etc. They're just, you know, working people, etc. But how do we explain that, let's say, not just the media, but also the intelligentsia, the intellectual classes, professional classes, managerial, cultural managers of society, you might say the top 20% of society. Mm-hmm. You think about 20-80 society, the 80% are ordinary people, the 20% are somehow in the managerial echelons, you know, etc. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, politicians, why is there such uniformity of understanding or opinion about such issues like the coup, the hidden histories of U.S. empire? Why do they all go along? Is it that they don't know? They're also subjected to this propaganda system, or are they being disciplined in some way? They know, but they don't act as they should, if they were honest. If that's so, what are the disciplinary machinations that are being used to silence them? You know, it's like, do you have any opinion on that?
Oh, yes. I think it's mainly the economic system. And if you want to succeed in it, obviously you have to select something where you can succeed. And since the overriding ideology is that, and since, for example, oil extraction, the whole sense that it's our oil and their land, is all tied in together. So if you become a cheerleader of that, then you get paid better, you know? So if you want to make a better life for yourself, your family, your children, get two cars instead of just one, et cetera, get more square footage in your house, then it behooves you to subscribe to that dominant ideology, because they are the ones in charge. And if you bow in front of it, then you will succeed. If you don't, you won't. It's a pretty simple like that. And unfortunately, most people, the 80% that you mentioned, are so busy trying to make ends meet that they don't have the time to educate themselves or even find out what is really going on. So they get these misconceptions of what is going on. And that's where the mainstream media is there to tell them, or rather to confuse them about what's really going on. So wonderful. I mean, just to give you an example, here we just had Helene, the hurricane. And this is, so the section of known by the deplorables, for example. I haven't met, we both, my wife and I, haven't met more gentle, caring, generous people in our lives, you know? And but of course, we can't talk politics because the confusion sets in, you see. And they think that, you know, we can go on about what they think or what I think or what we think. But that is the role. And to go back to what you asked, therefore, how can somebody in the mainstream media who is making 200,000 plus a year know what these people feel? And hence they only dine with their own kind and talk about where they can go on vacation and where they can have the privileged life that they so well earned, etc., etc. Now I might sound very bitter, but those are the facts.
So essentially, to reduce your argument, is you think they are bought off. They're well paid, and they don't rock the boat, because rocking the boat meaning they might have to drive an Uber.
Correct. Yeah.
They want to keep their privileges.
Driven by one of those Islamic drivers. Oh yes. My God, the horror.
Pakistani. There's a lot of
Pakistani. Yeah, exactly.
Drivers and stuff. Yeah, in Europe. But now, in general, I think that's a defensible insight. The system does work that way. It has the wherewithal to give lots of material rewards to people who go along. There's no doubt about it. Now, do you think there's an exception here in terms of the system's abilities or toolbox, let's say, to use against dissident viewpoint when it comes to the question of Israel, Palestine, and Zionism? Because now we are seeing that since October 7 of 2023, you could say the question of Palestine has been transformed in terms of the public relations aspect of it. The entire globe, in the global south mostly, has turned against it. A lot of people in the United States have turned against it. A lot of youth, young people have done so in the campuses, etc. And we also
and many of them Jews.
And many of them, yeah, Jewish Americans. And now we see that maybe the propaganda machinery and the indoctrination system is not working properly in this case. So they have now different tools to deal with it. Firing of professors, you know, militarizing university campuses.
Yes.
And eliminating, you know, various sites on social media that are, from their perspective, propagating pro-Palestinian perspectives or anti-Israeli or anti-Zionist or anti-Semitic, you know, perspectives. So what are your thoughts there? Do you think that exception is relevant to discuss?
Actually, very relevant, since I brought the mainstream media. Why, as a reporter, if you're interviewing Blinken, Secretary Blinken, why don't you ask, why is it that you have two passports? Is this normal for somebody in the government to have two passports? Mm-hmm. One American and the one Israeli. So who do you represent? Mm-hmm. So that would be a question that I would ask him. And that would, I mean, how many people even know about that? And how many people know about that the State Department and many people working in the government are dual nationality, carry the American passport as well as Israeli passport. Mm-hmm. So that gives us a real insight into whose interest is represented.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, speaking of Blinken, I think when he first visited Israel after October 7, famously he went there and met Netanyahu and said, I'm coming here as a Jew.
There we go, yeah.
And yeah. There's so many problems with that.
Problems is a mild way of putting it.
I mean, one obvious problem is that not all Jews have uniformity of opinion. And you could even say that's an anti-Semitic statement to say, right. I'm coming as a Jew and therefore I represent all the Jewry of the world. Obviously, mm-hmm. there are Zionist Jews and then there are other Jews, liberal Zionists and
right. Hardcore
Zionists. So that's one problem. And of course, the other one is now you're coming representing a state, United States. And perhaps that perspective that he took explains why he's going along with every wishes of Netanyahu. Do you agree?
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, he said it. I don't have to agree with it. He said it. He said the quiet words aloud. So, which also explains a lot that he doesn't have to fear that saying that is going to put him in a bad position. Mm-hmm. Because just like this is very class-based also, you know, you talk to your own kind and you don't expect them to start disagreeing with you on those bases, you know. Mm-hmm. So in some ways, I mean, I come from a very upper-class Iranian background. So mm-hmm. in some ways, I am like the American Jewish protesters. I am a self-hating Iranian or Persian, I should say. So, yeah, I mean, this is, to unravel this, it's so, with each layer, you find out things and how connecting the dots To me, basically, all of these problems come down to undemocratic economy. Mm. When a private a group of people, a minority, controls the majority, the minority doesn't work. I mean, I'm being, putting it in simple terms, and the majority does work for them. You know, yeah. Not for themselves, yeah. But for them. So if they could work for themselves and they could fulfill what they need as opposed to say, I have produced this and I'll get X amount for it, and then I can buy a car and have the vacations or whatever. No, I need to this because it's useful. Mm-hmm. It forms a use and not a terms of money, you know, and that's the whole point that this is something I'm working on to show that, simply put, just make a fist and put on it undemocratic economy and then open your fingers, racism, poverty, colonialism, you name it, all of the isms that we are suffering under, it's all connected. Unfortunately, people do not connect these fingers to that fist. Okay. And that's basically where I come from, that as long as we don't have a democratic economy, we're going to have all of these. You name it, they're connected. So well, here, I'll get off my soapbox.
We only have 1 minute left. Okay. So let me just say, how do you respond to people who might critique you and say you're being a reductionist, like economistic reductionism or whatever? You're reducing everything to economics.
Well, you could criticize that in that well, but if you look at history and connect those dots, for example, racism, what's this basis? You know, why do we have racism? Why do we have classes? Why do we have, you just name it, all of those fingers. And there is an economic component to it. Mm-hmm. Just like, why go to Iran and overthrow a democratically elected government, a government for the people, not for some and not for others, but for all? And then why?
Yeah, you're not suggesting that there is no gender oppression or racial oppression. You're saying that those exist, but they're connected to the economic form.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Yes.
All right.
And it's world history.
Okay. Well, thank you, Cambiz, for joining us and accepting my invitation. I enjoyed the conversation with you, and I urge everyone to check out your documentary, The Inheritance, the film.
And thank you for listening, and I really appreciate your invite, and thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Salaam alaikum.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.